Question number one, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
The impact of Brexit on funding has not been a positive one. We will no longer have access to programmes like the European Social Fund, the European Regional Development Fund, or those competitive programmes like Connecting Europe Facility. In its 2017 manifesto, the Conservative Party promised full replacement for EU structural funds via the Shared Prosperity Fund. However, we've been excluded from the policy development and design of this fund, and it's likely to be delivered centrally by Whitehall, bypassing the executive. The result is 70 million annual loss to the executive spending power. 315.6 million has been agreed in agricultural support for 21-22, but Treasury will deduct the receipts we get from the current programmes from this. The deduction is estimated at 34 million over the next 3 years, which I consider lost. On a more positive note, Brexit's not impacted on the Peace Plus programme, which is due to have a fund of some 1.1 billion euros over the next 7 years. This is approximately double the total allocation to the 2014-20 Peace 4 and Interreg programmes.
I call Andrew Muir for supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and thank you for the Minister for his response. One area of real concern for myself is European Social Fund support that really helped a significant number of organisations across Northern Ireland. So I want to ask the Minister what work is being done to mitigate the impact of loss of that funding and whether you'll meet with the Now Group, who obviously operate in my constituency and other areas, providing valuable support funded through ESF.
Well, we have had numerous engagements, particularly with people in social enterprise who are providing a very, very valuable service, in both in terms of creating a business, but also ensuring that people who perhaps wouldn't have access to employment or need other supports can get support through that and can find work and can find skills. And they do a hugely valuable exercise. Of course, the replacement for that, the Community Renewal Fund and those other Shared Prosperity Fund, as I said, are operated directly from Whitehall. While there may be an opportunity for groups like that to bid into them, we aren't able to prioritise, we aren't able to match the funding to the priorities this executive have. It is really an element of chance as to whether they will get funding through that or not. Some departments have been asked for kind of some high-level view in relation to whether some of these applications match their priorities, but we don't have any sense of what value that would have, whether that ensures they get the funding, or indeed, in the reverse, if we say it doesn't match a priority, are we denying funding to a project which doesn't come back into our coffers then to be distributed against our own funding priorities? So it's a very, very unsatisfactory issue. We've continuously raised it with Treasury. I was over last week with the Scottish and Welsh finance ministers, and we pressed the Chief Secretary of the Treasury on our entire dissatisfaction across the devolved areas for how this funding is operating. And it leaves us very much that those groups are in a competing with other groups from England, Scotland and Wales, and the executive has little or no influence over the distribution of that money to very, very valuable and deserving of support projects.
I call Gemma Dolan.
Minister, peace funding has been very valuable to community groups, not only in my constituency, but across the North. So will there be a reduction in the administrative burden for small community groups applying to the European Peace Plus programme?
Well, I'm very pleased that the programme itself got the necessary approval at the North-South Ministerial Council last week, albeit not in the meeting that it was intended to go to, but nonetheless, it is important. And we have had many discussions, both with the SEUPB, with the department in the South as well, but also in our discussions with the community and voluntary sector and others who apply for peace funding about their experience over the years and the difficulty in accessing funding. So there is a very strong push on this new programme to make sure it is more accessible, less bureaucratic. We have had some economists from our own department advise SEUPB in how to do that. They've had very strong input, as I say, from community and voluntary sectors and others, and they've assured us that they're listening to that feedback, and so I do expect to see a much more streamlined, much more accessible approach for funding applications.
I call Matthew O'Toole.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Minister, you just mentioned economists from your own department. A lot of what's happened since particularly January this year has been either lack of information or faulty information. Can I ask you to pledge now or to commit now to, as part of the budget exercise we're all expecting in the run-up to the election next year, to properly get someone, people in your department and working with the economy department if necessary. I'm coming to my question, Mr. Deputy Speaker, to map the costs of Brexit to this economy, including lost ESF and structural funding, and also the potential economic benefits of unique dual market access. Can I ask that you and the economists in your department undertake and publish that work ahead of next year?
Well, that would also require a very strong input from the department, from the economy themselves. And he may know that previously myself and other executive colleagues, including his own colleague, have asked that the Department of Economy actually put forward a prospectus in relation to the benefits that we have of having one foot in the British markets and one foot in the European markets. And as yet, we have not received anything. I'm happy to do whatever mapping and information gathering we can do in the time ahead, but I can't vouch for the Department for the Economy in that regard. But I do think it is incumbent on us to give a very clear picture of what funding has been lost and what opportunities do still arise.
I call Jim Allister.
Despite his own and his party's doom and gloom predictions, does the Minister acknowledge that direct payments to farmers in Northern Ireland have in fact increased significantly post-Brexit? On this very day, £301 million, with more to follow, is going out in direct payments compared to the total of 281 in the last year of common agricultural payments. Does the Minister acknowledge, though, that there is one restraint on agricultural aid, and that's the limit in the protocol on the amount that can be granted? Does the Minister support the protocol?
There's a number of questions there, Minister.
Well, I mean, the clutching at straws comes to mind, given the complete chaos that Brexit has been in Britain and potentially here as well, and the fact that we have the protocol arrangements has in some way insulated us from that and actually makes it all the more incumbent that we do get a sensible arrangement between the British government and the European Union. There has been £315.6 million agreed in agriculture support for 21-22, but the Treasury will deduct the receipts that from the current programme from this. We previously had the ability to carry those over into future funding for agriculture, and so we estimate that £34 million will be lost over the next 3 years.
Moving on, I call Melissa McHugh.
I've got to ask Carla Kestadaw a question too.
The NDNA commitments envisage that the number of ALBs will be rationalised, that there will be efficiency savings and a strengthening of democratic control and improved accountability. The Executive has agreed that the review should proceed. The Department of Finance has provided guidance to departments, and it will be for individual ministers to take forward a review of their ALBs, produce an action plan and report progress to the Executive. I am determined to drive this work forward and expect that all departments will be in a position to bring their timetables for reviewing their ALBs to the Executive early in the new year. The Department will then produce an annual report, and the Department will also bring forward a draft public bodies bill to facilitate the subsequent change process and to help drive the progress.
I call Melissa McHugh.
The Ratchis. August, by while I'm so fast, and I'd also like to just ask the Minister if he can give me an update on recruitment to the civil service in the area that has caused us great concern, given those that have been retiring out of the civil service and maybe the age profile of those who are currently in the civil service and some areas the lack of skill sets as well within the civil service.
Well, as the member will know from his, I suppose, his time on the Finance Committee, that reform is pressing ahead, primarily driven by the RHI report, but certainly was necessary in any set of circumstances, and there is a particular focus on recruitment and looking at the methods to fill vacancies in the civil service, more use of external recruitment or transfer of existing staff, but we move away from the use of internal promotion boards to external recruitment as a default method to fill vacancies. So that's one just of a suite of policies, if you like, to try and bring the necessary skills into the civil service, to change the age profile of a civil service, which is much too high, and also to ensure that we have that influx, as I say, of from all sectors of society, all genders, all regions that we represent here, to make sure that we have one which is balanced and represents the broad swathe of the population that we have.
I call Steve Aiken.
Okay. Thank you very much. I didn't thank the Minister for his reply so far. Particularly on the issue of arm's length bodies, Minister, have you set any targets for the reduction in the number of arm's length bodies? And have you discussed with the Independent Fiscal Council how we could be looking to reduce the overall administrative burden of the number of arm's length bodies we have?
Well, that commitment is part of the NDNA, as you will know, agreement which brought the executive back into being. It's a process that we long talked about over many years and many executives. Most of the arms and bodies are a product of direct rule over those number of years, and there's a very strong case for the reduction of them. I think the parties recognised that when they agreed the new decade, new approach agreement, that there was a need to rationalise. It wasn't just a review, there was a need to rationalise and reduce that number. I would think that there are quite a number of them are surplus to requirements, can be brought back into departments, could be merged, have their functions dealt with another way. And I think that would give more transparency, democracy, more influence of this House, indeed, over those bodies than is currently the case. So I'm very keen that this goes ahead. We have engaged with the departments on it. We have given them a template for conducting a review. We expect that to be with us early in the new year, and we will be pushing ahead with legislation to facilitate. Each department will have a responsibility for its own bodies. So I can't set a target for everyone, but I have a very firm view that we are substantially way more of these bodies that we need. They are not a product of devolved government, they are a product of direct rule government, and we need to address it.
I call Chris Little.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister how he will ensure that independent advocacy is retained for key sectors such as the arts and sport as part of this review?
Well, it's going to be for each department to make an assessment on, firstly, the accountability in relation to them, the affordability of them, the functions that they have in relation to departments, and their whole range. And obviously, each department have a different set. And I've no doubt some of them are performing very good functions, but the question has to be asked, is that function continue to be required in a devolved scenario where you have a function in assembly and committees for each department? Bear in mind, many of these bodies were set up, as I say, under the period of direct rule to provide some veneer of local democratic input into decision making from NIO ministers. And so there not only is a cost attached to them, but there is also an accountability and a responsibility deficit in terms of their relationship with the departments and through those departments to this institution. So I think a long, hard look is needed to look at each one of those, but to also ensure that the advocacy that you talk about is continued, be that within a department or through this institution itself.
I call Liz Kimmins.
Gormel, good. Kesha Tree, question three.
This is an Irish Government initiative with further details published on the 4th of October this year as part of the National Development Plan. The plan includes significant references to a number of major strategic investments initiatives, including the Peace Plus programme, the Economic Corridor and Strategic Rail Review. Some €500 million capital funding has been made available for the Shared Island Fund as part of the National Development Plan. Key criteria for the fund will include delivery of all Ireland benefits. I'm also aware that over the past year or so, the Irish Government has announced that this fund will provide funding for a number of projects in the border region. I hope to meet Minister McGrath later this month to discuss further how the National Development Plan would be delivered and how the Executive might usefully engage at the strategic level with its delivery and that of the Shared Island Fund alongside our own investment plans.
I call Liz Kimmins for supplement.
Gormel, I thank the Minister for his answer. Minister, you will be aware, and it will be no surprise, that I'm raising this of the proposal around the city park for Newry, which is a key priority for the vital regeneration of Newry City. And whilst it's heartening to hear that Newry Mourne and Down District Council have submitted a bid to the complementary fund within your own department for the project, I would be keen to hear, based on your engagements with the Shared Island Unit, what scope you see within the Shared Island Fund to finance the park. Gormelgut.
Well, I thank the member for her question, and I know that she has been very keen in relation to this particular project as part of the overall and a key component part of the overall Newry regeneration proposition, some of which are coming through the City Deal proposals that would hopefully will be announced another major staging post in the not too distant future. Of course, the bid for the complementary fund will be assessed with other bids across the north, with the exception of the North West City deal. The complementary fund applies right across the north, and so I'm very much welcome the council putting a bid in for that. I think from my own discussion, and knowing as you do the strategic location of the proposed park in Newry, on that linkage, the Greenway linkage from Carlingford right ostensibly to Portadown, if you take the towpath in as well, that this would be a very strategic location along that. It has that All-Ireland component to it, and I would hope, I know you've had some dialogue already with the people who operate the Shared Island Fund, and I would hope that that also is potentially a fruitful proposition in terms of the usage of that fund, which would hopefully would complement the Newry and Mourne Down District Council's own pursuit of funding in relation to it.
I call Justin McNulty.
And thank the Minister for his answers thus far. And I'm delighted to say, as an SDLP representative, that my party have supported Albert Basin Park every step of the way. And it's fantastic that other parties have come on board of late, and that's very, very, very positive. Minister, you talked about the Shared Island Fund in terms of commitments from the Irish Government. What are your commitments as Finance Minister to that fund to develop infrastructure on this island, to develop opportunities on this island? And what are your commitments to the Albert Basin Park development as Finance Minister for this part of this island?
I'm not sure who he's referring to in terms of latecomers to the party in relation to the idea of a park in Newry, but I'm sure he'll articulate that at some stage. In relation to that, I have engaged very frequently with the Department of Taoiseach and others who are running the Shared Island Fund. I want to bring a prospectus from that to the executive to make sure that the executive engage with, to make sure that in particular the infrastructure minister has an opportunity to engage that, so that the plans that the executive have with the limited capital pot that we have maximum value when they're being used across the island, so that they can hook up with the National Development Plan, but also with the Shared Island Fund, which is a component part of that. So I'm very much keen to do that, to make sure that our programmes in the executive, the funding that we have, which can actually be enhanced through an engagement with other sources of funding, be it Peace Plus or the Shared the Shared Island Plan, and that we maximise the potential for that for cross-border infrastructure, which has been suffering from a lack of investment for decades.
I call Andrew Muir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his response. Can the Minister please outline what the impact the potential continued boycott of North-South bodies by the DUP will have upon this investment and this much welcome investment in Northern Ireland?
Well, I think it is incumbent on all of us, regardless of our political outlook or the current nonsense that's going on in relation to the protocol, to ensure that whatever limited funds we have, and we do have limited funds, and we always recognise that, that we make maximum use of them for the benefit of all the citizens we represent here and right across the island. And therefore, when there is other funding available, be that Peace Plus or be that the Shared Island Fund, that we cooperate and collaborate with it as best we can, as there is a willingness from the South to do the same, to get the maximum benefit for citizens right across Ireland. And so interference with North-South arrangement, which are a component part of the three strands of the Good Friday Agreement. There's this institution, there are North-South arrangements and the East-West arrangements, and most parties want to operate those fully for the benefit of all citizens and in faithful observance of the agreement itself. So the interference in that only serves to disrupt potential investment, disrupt potential arrangements between the governments North and South to make sure that we get the best benefit for all of our citizens. These things are built on the premise of mutual benefit. So when you disrupt them, you're actually undoing the benefit for the citizens that the DUP claim to represent.
Moving on, I call Linda Dillon.
Question number four.
The budget for Peace Plus has now been confirmed at almost £1 billion. The SEUPB produced a final draft cooperation programme document which the Executive approved under urgent procedure last Wednesday, and the North-South Ministerial Council agreement was obtained on last Thursday, the 14th of October, at the Health and Food Safety meeting. Irish Government approval is also in place. The programme will now be submitted to the European Commission for its consideration and approval, and it's hoped that all necessary approvals would be in place to allow the SEUPB to open the programme for early calls in 2022.
Call Linda Dillon.
Thank you, Mr. Minister, for his answer. And much in the same vein as Andrew O'Meara's question, what does the continued boycott of the NSMC meetings by the DUP mean for this fund? And I certainly can speak as a representative for Mid Ulster of the importance of EU funding for my constituency, for my own immediate area, but for the wider Mid Ulster area in terms of particularly around infrastructure and education, but right across the board. So what does this mean? What does this boycott mean for those people who rely on this fund?
Well, the member may know that the meeting that was intended to deal with this and had been agreed by the executive as part of our schedule of North-South sectoral meetings is due actually this Friday. It was the SEUPB sectoral meeting, and in the expectation that the DUP were going to continue the boycott and also to ensure that the required executive approval was in place for the paper, I asked the executive to take the paper by urgent procedure. I also asked then the health minister to bring it to his meeting of the health and food safety body to ensure that north-south meeting, which was going ahead, was able to provide the necessary clearance. And I thank the health minister here for doing that, putting it onto his own agenda and ensuring that there was clearance for that paper. Because, as I've said, it's just a couple of million short of £1 billion. It's over 7 years. It's a huge funding programme which will benefit communities right across the north, be they living along peace lines, be they border rural communities, be it capital or resource, be they communities in the six border counties in the south, and the potential for it is enormous. So to continue to interfere with that, it was, you know, essentially cutting off one's nose to spite one's face, and absolutely risking the rollout of that programme, which is based on a spend per year. So anything that was lost in the first year, if it was delayed, goes back to where it came from. It isn't kept for continuation of use. I think the ongoing boycott will continue to damage that. And this Friday's meeting is scheduled to go ahead. It is scheduled to deal with other matters relating to the SEUPB and the rollout of peace, not the approval for the action programme itself, which thankfully is now in place. But it is scheduled to do that. So these are very necessary to make sure that these programmes can operate and do so smoothly and become more and more accessible, as other people have asked, for ordinary communities on the ground.
I call Matthew O'Toole.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. Minister, since the operation of Peace Plus is a component part of the UK's the withdrawal agreement, including the protocol, have any DUP ministers put an on-the-record objection in to spending SEUPB and Peace Plus money, given that they find that agreement so objectionable?
Well, I think the contrary is the case, because I did hear the First Minister lauding the fact that there was health-related funds associated with the Peace Plus funding and saying that was one of the reasons why they allowed it to go ahead onto the last Thursday's agenda, which wasn't the correct meeting for Peace Plus to be approved. But clearly it is a very substantial fund, and there's a very generous contribution from all of the contributors to that fund, and it can do some very, very valuable work on the ground for communities. And I think any attempt to interfere, as I say, we do have a meeting on Friday. We want to make sure that the processes are right. We now have the funding package in place. Any interference in that only serves the detriment of all of our citizens.
I call Kelly Armstrong.
And thank you, Minister, and I absolutely welcome the announcement about Peace Plus coming forward. I was very fortunate to meet community representative of community development networks across Northern Ireland, and they have asked for clarification when the Peace Plus money comes forward. How will it meet social and economic development needs, and will it be provided to councils or straight to community-led organisations to reduce the administration?
Well, there are a range of pillars attached to it, and so I would encourage people to engage with the SEUP, engage with the programme. It will be a variety of delivery mechanisms, so some of that would be directly to community groups, some of it will be done through councils as well. But it's a very, very substantial fund. It's almost double what we previously had. It's over 7 years, and so we expect some of the pillars to be rolled out early in next year, a call for some, at least some of them, and then progressing into the full programme beyond that. So I would encourage, as very many community groups have been involved in the consultation, and the issue of accessibility and reduction in bureaucracy and red tape has been very much to the fore, one that I've raised myself with the SEUPB. So I encourage groups to access the information and make sure they know how to access the funding and make the appropriate applications.
And I call Rosemary Barton.
Thank you. Question 5, Minister.
The Minister for Communities raised the matter of funding for the sub-regional stadia programme for soccer at a bilateral meeting with myself on the 16th of September. I'm aware that the Minister is progressing this issue, and I anticipate it forming part of the discussion on the upcoming multi-year budget.
I call Rosemary Barton for supplementary.
Thank you. Minister, we're all aware of the pressures across all the departments in relation to finances. Are you content that there's sufficient budget to commit to this programme?
Well, there was a commitment, I think it's 36.2 million was committed to the programme, and it remains there, that commitment to it. Of course, she will know, as all of us will know, that the cost of building has gone up very substantially, and we hope that that begins to level out or perhaps even start to come back down again. But I've no doubt, that's a substantial figure, but when it's spread across all of the facilities that might need it, we always could be doing with more. I'm the Minister for Communities, from my engagement, is very keen to get as much money into these programmes as she can. She's very keen to support sport, in this instance soccer, and then other sports as well. And so I've no doubt that she'd be making a very strong argument for this in the budget discussions.
I call Pat Sheehan.
Could I ask the Minister if funding will be available for the Casement Park regeneration as part of the executive budget?
Well, the Casement Park project is part of the Regional Stadia programme, which is a separate one from this soccer sub-stadia programme. Executive flagship programmes have been awarded priority ring-fenced funding in recent budgets, and funding for flagships has therefore been separate and distinct from other departmental budgets. So I have no doubt the Minister of Communities is looking at the business case for Casement, and the Executive has recognised that it has been a flagship project and they have been dealt with somewhat separately from other funding projects.
I call Justin McNulty.
Minister, in relation to Casement Park, can you confirm if you have received any bids from the Communities Minister for the additional costs that are obviously going to be necessary now as a come with delays to that project?
Well, it's not a case of making bids. It's not a monitoring round issue that people will come forward with bids, because the money's in there this year to do the work that was needed. That's already there. It's already been spent. Once all the necessary clearances are there, it's ready to spend. The question will be for the budgets coming up, and the budget discussions, which we've only just begun. We haven't got the final amount, and we will not know at the end of this month what amount is in that budget. And I have no doubt that the Communities Minister will be assessing the business case for Casement and making sure that the required case is put forward for, as I say, is an executive flagship project. So it's not just simply a responsibility of the Department of Communities. The executive agreed this is a priority project, and the funding would go to the Department of Communities to allocate, but I have no doubt, as part of the budget process, which we'll be getting into in the next couple of weeks, that the Communities Minister will be looking to that.
Moving on to our next question, I call Chris Little.
Question number 6, Deputy Speaker.
The public call for evidence of unsafe aluminium composite material cladding on properties over 18 metres was launched on the 21st of September. To date, my department has received one application for the remediation of SAM cladding. This has been assessed against the eligibility criteria for the £1 million SAM remediation fund. The public call is also open to high-rise residential buildings with unsafe non-SAM cladding to ascertain the extent of the issue here. When this is known, I will bring the information to the executive for its consideration of a non-SAM fund. The call for evidence will remain open until the 31st of October.
Call Chris Little.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The Finance Minister will be aware that a number of residents, such as those in Titanic Quarter Arc Apartments in my East Belfast constituency, have been seriously concerned to learn that they may be living in buildings with unsafe cladding. What total funding will these residents receive, and when will they receive it to complete the necessary remedial works to make their properties safe?
Well, and I've met with some of the residents, or certainly some of the building operators from those apartments. The priority has been, given the experience in Britain, has been 18 metres plus with SEM cladding. That's deemed to be the most high risk, and that's why the priority has been there. The Department for Finance doesn't have an overall role for this, but we have stepped up in this instance to operate the fund for that SEM cladding. We are expecting, because I did engage with Minister Gove, who's now taken over this department in London when I was over last week, we are expecting a further set of funding to roll out as a consequence of looking at other cladding issues, and the executive will receive its Barnett consequential off that. When our call for evidence has been complete, we'll have a sense of what the actual issues are here and what might be required to fix them, but I will certainly be asking the executive to ring fence that Barnett funding so it can be put to that use.
I call Robin Newton.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. In the same vein, Minister, can I ask, those apartments generally that may be in receipt of funding, and there are a myriad of potential applications coming forward, either from owners, for tenants, for those who have owned a number of apartments, or indeed for the developer themselves. What will be the mechanism under such circumstances for paying compensation to the individual tenant?
That's a question of whether the mechanism would apply only to the individual tenant or apply to multiple owners or to apply to facility owners. These issues are currently being worked through in London by that department. Over there, it's now comes under the unfortunate acronym of Deluxe, is the new department which is dealing with it. They have all of the necessary facilities in the one department. Here, the responsibility are spread across a number of departments. So we've been engaging through the Department of Finance very closely with them, and we'll continue to engage to get some information and sense of how it is intended to roll that fund out in England and where the lines, if you like, would be drawn between various materials, but also various occupying circumstances as well. And we intend to take some advice from that. As I say, we are expecting a fund to be put in place in England. We would expect a Barnett consequential from that, and I will be arguing that we do ring fence that to meet whatever requirements there are here.
And that is the end of our period of time for listed questions. We now move on to topical questions. Can I advise members that question one has been withdrawn? I call Justin McNulty.
The Finance Minister will know that more than 100,000 households across the North are being impacted by the cut to universal credit. Can I ask him if he has accepted the bid from his party colleague for £55 million to reverse this cut?
Well, can I remind the member himself that when we were dealing with the issue of welfare reductions and putting the argument forward for welfare mitigation fund, we were on our own in the executive parties at that time, and the other four parties, including his own, had agreed to a process of dealing with welfare reform without mitigations. Can also remind him that when the first budget was put together to put in the mitigation funds for welfare cuts, his party voted against that budget at that time. And can also remind him that the proposition he has put forward in his motion, either his party's motion, will create another cliff edge in relation to this matter within a short number of months, where people will be faced with exactly the same issue. What I want to see is a solution, and that's if the executive are willing to do it, which not only deals with the issue over the next number of months, but actually if the executive wants to continue on this programme and not create a cliff edge in accordance with his motion, then they would need to put in the three-year budget a programme to meet this cost in full, which in a number of years could go up as far as £200 million a year. And those are calls the executive is going to have to be made, are going to have to make. So it's not simply a matter of me meeting a bid. And I know he and perhaps his party colleagues are more interested in headline than an actual solution. It's not simply a matter of meeting a bid. It's the executive deciding if we have the funds to continue to undo the damage that Tories are doing to ordinary citizens right across Britain and also here. Scotland faces the same dilemma as do Wales. Those are issues that the executive are going to have to face, not only in this monitoring round, but also in relation to the setting of the three-year budget as well.
I call Justin McNulty.
Thank the Minister for his answer. I'll remind the Minister that his party handed over Tories welfare. And I'm really disappointed by the Minister and his party, and the fact that his party refused to accept responsibility for this. First it's the British Government, then it's the SDLP you're now accusing of being responsible. I am here representing families who've been left with nothing. Will he accept responsibility and reverse this cut?
Can I say it to the member, the uplift in universal credit was brought in by the British government. He knows that, I assume. His own party failed to stop it in Westminster, although they have lectured us about being allow me to finish the answer.
Order.
His own party failed
order,
to stop
order,
it.
Order, members. Right. The minister is being asked to answer the question. Please allow him to do so. I'd also ask the minister to address the chair and keep things in order. Thank you.
His own party failed to stop this issue in Westminster. They have lectured us about being where it counts and when it counts, but it didn't count for them over in Westminster. And they've now tried to impose the problem not on the executive, but actually on Sinn Féin as a political party. And what I'm saying is if the executive who take the decisions in relation to this want to deal with the issue of universal credit uplift, they will need to do it in a long-term basis, or else his proposition will bring us back to a cliff edge within a short number of months, again, for the people who he professes to be here speaking on behalf of. That's a call the executive are going to have to make. I'm very happy to provide them with the information, facilitate the reduction from each department if that's the way that the executive want to go, but that's a call they will have to make, and I will be there to support them if that's the call that they want to make.
I call Rosemary Barton.
Minister, what oversight and input have you had in delivering the RHI lessons that have been identified?
Well, the RHI report has finally been through executive clearance. As you will know, that the subcommittee met for some time when the executive was reformed. All of the parties, the executive, were involved in that subcommittee that produced a report dealing with the recommendations. So we now have a corporate response from the executive, agreed and reported, I think, on the 6th of October this month, has been published, and that's the executive's corporate response. That, of course, looks at all of the issues of the codes, of strengthening issues in relation to accountability and transparency. It also looks at their broader issues in terms of civil service performance and recruitment issues in relation to civil service. So the response has been published. What I want to ensure is that we continue with the reform programme that arises from the lessons learnt by RHI, and that we bring them forward to we have a better system working, and ensure that a scheme like this could never be either conceived or operated or developed and conducted in the manner that the RHI scheme was done.
I call Rosemary Barton.
Minister, the written statement from you 2 weeks ago showed a marked similarity to the response made by senior civil servants to the RHI inquiry in 2018. Bearing in mind the 7 significant areas for improvement identified then, could the Minister tell us why it has taken so long, particularly as he is chair of the Executive Subcommittee?
Well, can I say the Executive Subcommittee did report back to the Executive, I think it was back in April. Certainly at least 6-9, actually I think it was earlier, it's perhaps 9 months ago. I don't have control over the allowing of papers onto an executive agenda, but the subcommittee did its work in good time, presented to the executive. It did not get onto the agenda until last week, or the week before last, and it was published eventually. I want to see, we've continued on, as I say, in working on codes, working on civil service reform, working on a range of issues from it, and I want to see those matters progressed as quickly as possible.
I call Robbie Butler.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Has the Minister undertaken any discussion with the Justice Minister in relation to the Northern Ireland Civil Service Injury Benefit Scheme?
Well, we've been communicating with all of the ministers, particularly those affected. I know that the Minister for Justice would have some civil servants within, or some employees within her department that would certainly be affected by the outcome of that. So, yes, we have been consulting with all executive colleagues in relation to it.
I call Robbie Butler for supplement.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Thank the Minister for his answer. Is the Minister confident that the provisions within the generic Northern Ireland Civil Service policy fully and safely address the unique environment that prison officers work in relation to permanent injuries?
Well, we have to operate on the advice that we get, and the advice that we get is that that is the case. And I know this has gone to committee as well, so it will come to scrutiny of this House, and if people have a different argument to make, that's the place they can make it, and of course they can scrutinise this policy and legislative proposal as it goes through the Assembly. But certainly the advice I have received is that people are confident that this is ensuring that there is ongoing protection for workers in that regard.
John Stewart is not in his place. I call Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you, Deputy Chair. Minister, this month I welcome the consultation that has opened on the proposals for the amendment of the Technical Book Guidance to Part F, that's the conservation of fuel and power. As we know, the Northern Ireland Housing Executive does have a stock that may never be able to meet these standards. Can you confirm if there's any capital monies being considered in the multi-year budget to bring those many thousands of housing executive homes up to the new home standard?
Well, I mean, obviously we've been talking to all departments ahead of the multi-year budget, and we did have a kind of a high-level planning session in relation to a number of themes, obviously with health being the number one theme for the executive. But we are looking at other issues in terms of anti-poverty, vulnerable people, green growth agenda, which will include retrofitting, and it will be something that I'm sure the department, the communities will be talking to us and making propositions in relation to when they come to put their case for the three-year budget.
I call Kelly Armstrong for supplementary.
Thank you so much, and thank you very much, Minister. I'm just wondering, can you outline to this House how the cross-departmental budget planning and management of that budget goes forward so that we ensure that no departments are working in silo, as you have mentioned, because something like housing, for instance, is a cross-cutting thing? Thank you.
Well, one of the points I've made to my executive colleagues that I hope would break that down is we're actually setting the budget for the next executive. So none of us may be in the position that we're currently in when that budget comes into play. And so in that sense, I ask people to set aside their departmental interests and look at the broader interests of what will continue to be a very limited budget for us, but at least gives us a chance to plan over a three-year basis with that budget. So there is an opportunity to set priorities. There's an opportunity, however painful that might be, for departments to try and set the necessary resources to meet those priorities. And that does involve the executive working together as a team without focusing on their internal priorities of their own departments.
I call Ciara Ferguson.
Minister, following your meeting with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury, can you provide an update on funding for the victims' payment, please?
Yeah, well, I met the Chief Secretary, the new Chief Secretary of the Treasury last week over in London. We've had an ongoing discussion and a potential dispute with Treasury in relation to that. It's no secret that the Executive have a position and have agreed a position that the British Government, having legislated, having developed the policy for the victims' payments, legislated for that and brought it through themselves under their own statement of funding policy. Procedures have a responsibility to fund that, and that's the ongoing. Now, the Executive have agreed, in order to ensure that the scheme can get up and running and that victims can be paid out in the near here and now, the Executive have agreed to cover that cost, but we reserve the right to press Treasury to meet its obligations. I continue to do that. I had a good conversation with the Chief Secretary of the Treasury about that. They are obviously in the middle of the spending review, which the outcome will be known at the end of the month. He has promised to come back to it very, very quickly on the other side of that. But we do reserve the right to examine legal options if that dispute resolution process with the Treasury has not worked.
I call Ciara Ferguson for supplementary.
Minister, did you get any indication from the Chief Secretary as to what you expect to get from the spending review?
No, unfortunately not, but the Treasury in these matters always keep their cards very close to their chest because they don't want us making their announcements for them ahead of the 26th, 27th of October. So we haven't any clear, but we did meet with both Scotland and Wales with the Treasury Minister, and we did press them on a number of issues in relation to our common interests. And obviously we're hoping for the best possible outcome from the spending review.
And I call Anya Murphy.
Minister, would you agree with me that the £1 billion of Peace Plus programme funding is hugely important to the preservation of local reserves such as Culca Mountain?
Well, I had an opportunity to visit Culca for the first time last week. I have to say I was very impressed, not just by the beauty of the place, but also the work that's going on there. And that was a consequence of an EU-funded programme which was shared by ourselves here in the north, the south and Scotland. There was a three-way share there. So when we were actually meeting the people there, we were talking to people from the south and by Zoom from a guy from Aberdeen who was doing an awful lot of the technical research that is required for saving and restoring boglands and wetlands here. The potential of those lands for if you like, storing carbon and making sure that there's a reduction in carbon emissions is huge, besides the fact that they need to be restored. So there's ongoing work, and of course that requires collaboration with farmers who have access and have ownership of the land, but it's a hugely impressive project. It's a consequence of EU funding, and I would hope that under the Peace Plus funding that we have, that projects such as that can continue to be supported because they're vital to our future.
I call on you, Murphy, for a supplementary.
Minister, would you agree that the Peace Plus Fund is a lifeline for many border communities, given that Brexit has had such an impact on them border communities and indeed in rural areas, and it is important that this fund has to be sustained and made sustainable?
Well, as I said in response to previous questions, we have 7 years now. We have just short of £1 billion sterling, €1.1 billion. That will have the capacity to have an enormous impact on the ground in border areas and also across the six counties generally and in the border counties in the south for communities. And it's very much to be welcomed because in the loss of other European funding, which a lot of communities were and organisations, social enterprises were dependent on to provide skills, provide jobs for people, to provide programmes for people, then the Peace Plus is the only sort of funding left that we have that, that ordinary community groups and other projects on the ground can apply to from Europe. So it's hugely important that continues to play a role, and I look forward to the next 7 years to see many, many more community projects getting supported through it.
I call Claire Sugden.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister if he has received any bids or expressions of interest to support those who will be most affected by the expected energy and other costs this winter?
No, I know that there is some Barnett consequential for the Tories announced at the start of the party conference, obviously, to give some measure of support to people. I think it's much short of what the Department for Communities themselves provided last year. And so I'm sure that the Minister for Communities is looking to see how she can provide some assistance to those who normally would get support for winter heating and allowances there. But there is a very substantial hike, as she will know, particularly in gas. And that's going to be very, very challenging because that's a private sector manner. But it is going to push more and more people into fuel poverty. And these are all very, very significant challenges that the executive are going to have to face. And we've had this discussion about the universal credit uplift. We have all of the challenges, as I say, of ongoing opportunities or attempts to try and undo Tory policy by spending money that we would otherwise be spending on our own public services. And that's the balance that we continuously face.
And that is our end of period of time for questions to the Minister of Finance. I would ask members to take their ease for a few moments before we go on to our next item of business, which will be a motion on inter-parliamentary dialogue.